The digestive system is responsible for breaking down food and absorbing nutrients. Diseases of the digestive system interfere with this function. The primary part of the digestive system is the alimentary canal. This is simply a tube, and the digestive systems are located along it. Most of the alimentary canal is in the abdominal cavity. The abdominal cavity itself is a closed space lined with the peritoneum. There is no normal flora in the peritoneal cavity. Accessory structures assist with the digestive process. These are things outside the alimentary canal, but they contribute to the breakdown and absorption of food. Things like the teeth, the salivary glands, the liver, the gallbladder, and the pancreas. In terms of normal flora in the digestive system, the mouth and pharynx has a wide variety of microbes. Pretty much every kind of microbe can be found in this part of the digestive system. The stomach is fairly acidic, and the duodenum has numerous digestive enzymes, so there's not a lot of bacteria that survive there. But as we go into the jejunum and all the way through the colon, there's another wide variety of microorganisms. In both locations, the normal flora of the digestive system provides microbial antagonism so that other organisms cannot grow there. The mouth is the entryway to the digestive system. Dental caries, or tooth decay, is one of the diseases of the mouth. Gingivitis is an inflammation of the gums, and periodontitis is gingivitis with an infection of the tissues that support and surround the tooth. All of these conditions have a negative impact on the ability of the tooth to carry out its function in the digestive system. Tooth decay starts when Streptococcus mutans and other normal flora form a biofilm on the teeth. This is known as dental plaque. As a result of food substances that are in the mouth, these bacteria can begin to produce acids which etch the enamel, and if that happens and the enamel is breached, the microorganisms can invade the tooth and decay the pulp of the tooth. Calcium salts can mineralize the plaque. This is known as tartar or dental calculus. The production of dental calculus triggers gum inflammation, and anaerobic pockets develop so that new bacteria can live in the mouth. Porphyromonas gingivalis actually breaks down gum tissue. This is what loosens teeth. One of the effects of periodontitis is the loss of teeth. Acute necrotizing ulcerative gingivitis, also known as trench mouth, is probably an interaction with a bacteria that's in the mouth and a spirochete. If these two are in the mouth at the same time, trench mouth can occur. Usually only one or the other is present. Dental caries is the start of all dental problems. These are diagnosed by a visual inspection. Small cavities can be filled to prevent further damage to the tooth. Prevention of dental caries and all other dental problems occurs with regular brushing to disrupt the plaque and regular flossing. Professional cleaning will remove the plaque and the tartar from the tooth so that gingivitis can't start. Healthy eating habits, making sure that you eat fresh fruits and vegetables that are raw sometimes, and that you don't leave a lot of sugars in your mouth. Drinking water after eating, even swishing your mouth with water is helpful. The addition of fluoride to water strengthens the enamel. Peptic ulcers are primarily caused by Helicobacter pylori. This is a gram-negative rod that's just slightly curved. Since peptic ulcers occur in the stomach, we have to have an organism that somehow overcomes the acid environment of the stomach. Helicobacter pylori can produce a protein that inhibits stomach acid production. It also has flagella that allow it to burrow into the gastric mucosa so that it can get away from the acid. And finally, this organism has the enzyme urease. Urea is in the gastric fluid. When this organism breaks down urea to ammonia, it literally puts a little alkaline coat around itself. Helicobacter enters in food and water. We know that many people have the organism, but not all people with the organism get ulcers. We believe it's transmitted through an oral fecal transmission. People with Helicobacter are more likely to develop ulcers if they use NSAIDs, alcohol, or tobacco. Because the gastric ulcer may eat through the stomach lining, there's the potential for perforation. If that happens, gastric contents will spill into the peritoneum and peritonitis may result. This organism can be treated with antimicrobials. It's about a 3-week treatment with a couple of different antibiotics. It appears that we do not want to kill all of the Helicobacter pylori because if all of them disappear, there is a risk for esophageal cancer. The prevention is to avoid oral fecal transmission. This basically is good hand washing. Also, if you use NSAIDs, abuse alcohol, or use tobacco, you can reduce your risk factors by cutting back on those things. Bacterial gastritis is an inflammation of the stomach or intestine because there are bacteria present. Regardless of the causative agent, the symptoms are always similar. Some individuals have virtually no symptoms, maybe a mild diarrhea. Most people who experience bacterial gastritis have nausea, vomiting, diarrhea, a loss of appetite, abdominal pain, and cramping. In severe cases, dysentery may occur. Dysentery is marked by very loose stools that may contain mucus and blood. Bacterial gastritis is typically diagnosed by the signs and the symptoms. Seldom are stomach contents cultured. The treatment is to make sure that fluid replacement occurs. Anti-nausea drugs may be given to help with the vomiting. Most cases of bacterial gastritis are self-limiting and they really do not seek the assistance of a physician. Because bacterial gastritis is typically caused by organisms that are transmitted in food, proper cooking, handling, and storage of food are important preventative measures. The common causes of bacterial gastritis are Shigella species, enteropathic strains of E. coli, Campylobacter jejuni, Clostridium difficile, Salmonella enterica, and Vibrio cholera. Shigellosis is caused by Shigella, which is a gram-negative bacillus. There are 4 different species of Shigella that are involved in bacterial gastritis. Shigella produce enterotoxins. These are the toxins that cause the diarrhea. The enterotoxins will bind to the intestinal cell surface membranes. This will trigger the loss of electrolytes and water from the cell, similar to the way cholera toxins act. Shigella frequently causes dysentery with blood and mucus appearing in the stool. Humans and apes are the only host. It is transmitted via the oral fecal route. Prevention is good hand washing to break that oral fecal transmission. Traveler's diarrhea is usually caused by E. coli. This is a gram-negative bacillus that is normal intestinal flora. However, there are at least 150 different serotypes of E. coli. A serotype has to do with the proteins that are found on the cell wall, the flagella, and the capsule of the cell. Those on the cell wall are the O antigens. On the flagella are the H antigens, and the K antigens are found on the capsule. E. coli really doesn't have a capsule, so only O and H antigens are found on E. coli. O157, O111, H8, and H7 are the serotypes on E. coli that are associated with virulence. E. coli O157H7 is one of the most dangerous serotypes of E. coli. This particular organism produces a toxin which gets in the blood and can cause kidney failure and death, particularly in the old and in the young. O157H7 is found in beef carcasses. About 50% of the beef carcasses have this. Undercooked ground beef can be a source of the disease. Other pathogenic strains can be found in water or on vegetables and various other foods. Many times you pick up a stray E. coli while you're traveling to other areas of the world, even other areas of the United States, and you get a mild diarrhea that's typically called traveler's diarrhea. Usually, the disease is self-limiting. Because of the vomiting and diarrhea, it's important that you maintain fluid levels. In some individuals, antimicrobials may be necessary. Prevention is to thoroughly cook ground beef and avoid cross-contamination in the kitchen. If you have raw meats on the counter and then you put on that same counter without adequately disinfecting it, food that won't be cooked or cooked food, then you may pick up the organism from the counter. That's what cross-contamination is. Also, carefully wash all vegetables. Campylobacter diarrhea is caused by Campylobacter jejuni. This is a gram-negative bacillus that's slightly curved. This is probably the most common cause of physician-treated diarrhea. It's associated with raw chicken or turkey, or with water that's been contaminated with feces from stockyards, feedlots, pastures, and things of that sort. Usually the disease is self-limiting. The symptoms occur 3 to 4 days after ingesting the material with the organism in it, so a lot of people miss what actually gave them the disease. This particular form of diarrhea is diarrhea and gas. It typically runs its course in about 3 weeks. Supportive therapy is necessary. If antimicrobials are given, they should be given early in the disease, since giving it later in the disease can lead to the development of the carrier state. You need to make sure that your drinking water is clean. You need to cook chicken and turkey thoroughly. And, of course, prevent cross-contamination in the kitchen. Raw chicken and raw turkey should never be placed with foods that are not going to be cooked or with already cooked foods. Antimicrobial-associated diarrhea is better known as C. diff. This is caused by Clostridium difficile, a gram-positive anaerobic endospore-producing bacteria. This is part of the normal intestinal flora of about 5% of the population. It stays in very small numbers because of the antagonistic competition with the other flora in the intestine. However, high doses of antibiotics can kill most of that flora. Clostridium difficile is very antibiotic resistant, and so it will be left behind. This means that it can grow and cause the problems of diarrhea. The organism can be transferred from one patient to another using the oral fecal route. The symptoms range from a relatively mild diarrhea, that's 5 to 10 clear, watery, but foul-smelling bowel movements per day, to severe pseudomembranous colitis. This is the one that you really want to avoid. In the serious form, there are more than 10 bloody stools per day. Intestinal lesions composed of connective tissue, dying white blood cells, and dead colon cells form. These are the pseudomembranes. This is what is shed in the diarrhea and accounts for the bloodiness of the stools. Treatment is to, first of all, stop the high-dose drugs that are causing the problem, and then recolonize the colon with normal flora. This can sometimes be done by having the patient eat yogurt. However, in extreme cases, fecal transplants have been done. They take feces from another person and reintroduce them into the colon of the sick person. You do not want to give antidiarrheal drugs because diarrhea is helping to flush the system. There are two major diseases that are caused by Salmonella. Salmonella enterica is a gram-negative bacillus. It's found in the intestines of most vertebrates, especially reptiles, but it is not normal flora for humans. There are over 200 serotypes of this particular organism. The serotypes Typhi and Paratyphi cause typhoid fever. The serotypes Enteritidis and Typhimurium are the most common causes of salmonellosis, which is a gastroenteritis. Salmonella is acquired through contaminated food or water. The carrier state exists in the human. The most famous carrier was Typhoid Mary. Poultry and poultry products can also contain Salmonella, so kitchen cross-contamination is a problem with this disease. Reptiles, because they harbor the organism as part of their normal intestinal flora, need to be carefully cared for if you have them as pets. The Salmonella serotype Typhi or Paratyphi has an infective dose of 1,000 to 10,000 cells. It passes from the intestine to the bloodstream, and then it's carried to the liver, the spleen, the bone marrow, and the gallbladder. The signs and symptoms of typhoid fever include fever, headache, muscle pains, malaise, and loss of appetite. The bacteria may be released by the gallbladder to the intestine. Here, it may cause perforation of the intestine so that peritonitis is a problem. Typhoid fever may last 4 weeks. Without treatment, 12 to 30% die. Salmonellosis is the gastroenteritis form of Salmonella diseases. Here, the organism stays confined to the intestine because it's a different serotype. This is either the serotype Enteritidis or Typhimurium. Usually, salmonellosis is self-limiting, running its course within a week or less. Because diarrhea and vomiting are hallmarks of the disease, fluid replacement therapy is a treatment. Prevention is through good hygiene, particularly in the kitchen, making sure your drinking water is clean, and being careful when handling reptiles, making sure you wash your hands thoroughly, and let's not let them free roam in the kitchen. Cholera is caused by Vibrio cholera. This is a gram-negative, slightly curved rod. This organism can survive in fresh and salt water. It produces a toxin known as cholera toxin. In order for the strain to be pathogenic, it has to have a plasmid. The plasmid carries the genes for the toxin. The toxin attaches to the intestinal cells. The cells then dump cell contents, so their cell fluid and their electrolytes end up in the lumen of the intestine. This leads to what are called rice water stools. The stools appear to be water that's thinly colored, and there's usually little bits of mucus floating in it. That's what looks like rice. Because all of the cells of the intestine are dumping their fluids pretty much simultaneously, there is rapid dehydration and electrolyte imbalance, and this disease can be rapidly fatal. It's treated by supportive care. Doxycycline will reduce the production of the toxin but does not really kill the organism. Good hygiene is usually sufficient to prevent this organism from developing disease. It takes an unusually high number of organisms to make you sick. There is a vaccine available, but the immunity does not last long. The cholera vaccine is sometimes given to National Guard troops if they're going into flood areas because they may be more exposed to cholera in those situations. Vibrio parahemolyticus is another species of Vibrio. For most people, this organism is not pathogenic. This organism can live in alkaline salt waters, so it is found in the Gulf Coast waters. A lot of people like to eat raw oysters. Well, oysters are filter feeders, so whatever is in the water ends up in the oyster. As long as you have a relatively healthy immune system, eating some oysters that contain Vibrio parahemolyticus should not give you a problem. However, immunocompromised individuals who eat raw oysters contaminated with Vibrio parahemolyticus can get very sick and even die. Bacterial food poisoning is an intoxication. Here the diseases are caused by the ingestion of toxins that are produced by bacteria. The bacteria are growing in the food and producing the toxin. The food contains the toxin. Staphylococcus aureus can produce an enterotoxin. This can cause vomiting, diarrhea, cramping, and intestinal discomfort. The vomiting and diarrhea may be relatively severe and dehydration may result. The disease usually resolves within 24 hours and is self-limiting. Staph aureus is salt tolerant and grows well at room temperature. Because Staph aureus may be normal flora on the skin, this organism is typically found in foods that are handled a lot while being made and then not properly refrigerated. The toxin does not change the taste or the appearance of the food. The prevention is, of course, proper food handling. There are a few viral diseases of the digestive system: oral herpes, mumps, viral gastroenteritis, and viral hepatitis. Oral herpes is caused by human herpes virus 1. These are fever blisters or cold sores on the lip that are quite painful. Occasionally, the virus will move to the inside of the mouth, and then you have herpetic gingivostomatitis. Usually, this condition is seen in individuals who have a lowered immune response. Herpetic pharyngitis is when there is an inflammation of the throat. There are no lesions, but the throat becomes inflamed. In immunosuppressed individuals, herpes esophagitis may develop. Here, the lesions are in the esophagus. They're extremely painful, and it makes swallowing very difficult. The herpes virus displays latency, so once you have the virus, you can have recurrences of the outbreak. The virus is acquired during childhood. There's some evidence that if you make it through puberty without having oral herpes, you may never get it. Active lesions are much more likely to transmit the disease than people who have the disease latently. Treatment is with acyclovir or pencyclovir. These are topical antivirals that will help shorten the outbreak. Prevention is to avoid contact with active lesions, including fomites. This can include things like toothbrushes, drinking after someone. While human herpes virus type 2 is typically thought of as causing genital herpes, about 10% of cold sores are the result of human herpes virus type 2. So oral sex is another means of transmission. Mumps is caused by a rubella virus, which is an RNA virus. This virus is spread in the saliva, and humans are the only known host. Primarily, this virus infects the parotid salivary glands. These are the ones that are sort of at the base of the tongue. As a result, the glands swell and swallowing is difficult. Typically, this disease runs its course in about a week. The virus can infect other organs. In males that get the disease after puberty, this may end up in the testes and cause sterility. In rare cases, mumps have caused meningitis and pancreatitis, and very rarely, deafness. Treatment is supportive care, and prevention is through vaccination. MMR, the first M, is the one for mumps. Viral gastroenteritis has the same symptoms as bacteria. Generally, the symptoms appear within 24 hours of acquiring the virus, and the symptoms last 12 to 60 hours. Supportive therapy is the usual treatment. You need to guard against dehydration because of the vomiting and the diarrhea. The common agents are RNA enteroviruses. The norovirus, which is a calciviridae, is the one that's been implicated on a lot of cruise ships. The astroviruses and the rotaviruses are the other enteroviruses involved. These viruses are more common in the winter because people tend to be crowded together in the winter. One reason we see it on cruise ships is because cruise ships have a lot of people crowded into one spot. The rotavirus is the most common cause of diarrhea in children, and of course children are very susceptible to dehydration. Rotaviruses have caused death in children. There is a vaccine available, and most doctors will administer it to children to help prevent them from getting rotaviruses. Hepatitis is an inflammation of the liver due to a number of things. It can be an autoimmune disease. It can be the result of drug or alcohol abuse. There are some genetic disorders that lead to hepatitis, and then there are microorganisms, primarily virus. Hepatitis will disturb the functions of the liver, which are numerous. The liver synthesizes clotting factors, it stores pretty much all of your nutrients, and it helps remove waste from the blood. People with hepatitis typically present with jaundice. Bilirubin, which is a yellow pigment, is not cleared from the blood as it should be, and jaundice is a yellow discoloration of the skin. Also, abdominal pain and fatigue are common with hepatitis. The waste products that are normally cleared by the liver accumulate in the blood, and this may lead to coma and death. There are five viruses that are involved in causing viral hepatitis: hepatitis A, B, C, D, and E. Hepatitis B is the only one of the five viruses that is a DNA virus. All of the others are RNA viruses. Hepatitis A is sometimes called infectious hepatitis. This is a self-limiting viral disease that usually runs its course in a week to 10 days. This virus is typically acquired through contaminated food and water using the oral fecal route. Hepatitis E is very much like A in terms of how it presents and how it is spread. We don't see hepatitis E much in this country, but it is seen in undeveloped countries. Hepatitis B, C, and D are transmitted through blood and body fluids. You can only get hepatitis D if you already have hepatitis B. D cannot infect by itself, but it will co-infect with B. There is some evidence that if you have both hepatitis B and hepatitis D, you have a higher risk of liver cancer. Hepatitis C usually has a subclinical presentation. Many people have it for years with no real symptoms, and by the time it's discovered, there's already been extensive liver damage. Because A and E are spread through contaminated food and water, good sanitation is helpful. B, C, and D are spread through body fluids, so care with handling body fluids is important. It is said that the multiply pierced and tattooed population is the largest population of individuals with hepatitis C, so it's probably a good idea to know your piercer and tattoo artist and make sure that they're always using sterile needles. There are vaccines for both hepatitis A and hepatitis B. There are two groups of parasitic diseases of the digestive system. One set is the diseases that are caused by protozoans. This would be giardiasis, cryptosporidiosis, and amoebiasis. And then we have the diseases that are caused by the helminths. These would be the tapeworms and the roundworms. Giardiasis is caused by Giardia intestinalis. This is a flagellated protozoan. You get this typically through contaminated drinking water. This is particularly associated with camping and with contaminated well water. The disease presents with diarrhea and flatulence. Usually it resolves spontaneously in a few days. However, antiparasitics may be given. Cryptosporidiosis is caused by Cryptosporidium parvum. This is a sporozoa, a protozoa that has no means of locomotion. This is a zoonosis. Animals contaminate drinking water, or humans who have it can transmit it to other humans through the oral fecal route. The disease presents as severe watery diarrhea that lasts for up to 2 weeks, so dehydration is a strong possibility. This is an AIDS marker disease. It's life-threatening in people who have AIDS. Amoebiasis is caused by Entamoeba histolytica, which is an amoeba. It moves by pseudopods. This is sometimes called Montezuma's revenge. Many individuals south of the border carry this amoeba as part of their normal intestinal flora and have no problems with it. You get this by drinking contaminated water. This is spread through the oral fecal route. You may have heard that if you go south of the border, don't drink the water. Don't use the water in any form. Don't use the water to brush your teeth. Don't use the water to wash your food in. Don't use the water. The treatment is support therapy to prevent dehydration. Antiparasitics can be given, and of course, the prevention is to make sure you drink clean water. There are three tapeworms associated with digestive system diseases. Taenia solium is associated with eating raw or improperly cooked pork. Taenia saginata is associated with beef, and Diphyllobothrium latum with cold water fish. Tapeworms are flatworms. They're flat, segmented worms that are sometimes called cestodes. They have a head which has a scolex. The scolex will either have suckers or hooks or both for attachment to the intestine. Then these worms are basically bags of reproductive organs. Each segment contains the reproductive organs, and as they move away from the scolex, they become filled with eggs. The segments will detach, they'll be shed in the feces, the appropriate animal will eat the eggs, the worms will hatch out and insist in the meat. Then people eat the meat. Proper cooking will destroy the larvae, and freezing also destroys the larvae. Taenia solium has an interesting little extra thing it can do, something called cystocercosis. Here, humans accidentally ingest the eggs, not the larva, but the eggs. The eggs hatch out in the human, and then they travel to either the muscle or the brain, where they insist. Those that insist in the muscle are usually asymptomatic. There may be a little muscle pain while they're moving around, but typically they insist and never cause any problem. Those that go to the brain, however, do brain damage, and this results in seizures and other neurological problems. The treatment for the intestinal tapeworms are things like niclosamide and praziquantel. These destroy the tapeworm head or the tapeworm scolex and allows the tapeworm totally to be shed from the body. Roundworms are also known as nematodes. The pinworm or seedworm is Enterobius vermicularis. Humans are the only known host. Humans ingest the eggs. The female then lives in the large intestine and comes out at night to deposit eggs in the perianal region. This makes the perianal region itchy. Little kids scratch their bottoms and then typically put their fingers in their mouth, so autoinfection is common. The way this is diagnosed is by taking a piece of scotch tape and sticking it to the kid's bottom, and then putting the piece of scotch tape on a microscope slide and looking for the eggs. If one person is found to have pinworm, the entire household is treated with antiparasitics, usually one dose and then wait 2 weeks and another dose of the antiparasitic. The eggs are very lightweight. If one individual has it, they have spread the eggs throughout the house, and every surface probably is contaminated with eggs. Everybody has picked them up some way or the other. The good news is the eggs become non-infective after a week, so you don't really have to go through and scrub the entire house. Ascaris lumbricoides is another one of the roundworms. Here the eggs hatch in the soil and the larvae are living in the soil. The larvae will penetrate the skin, particularly between the toes. They're carried in the blood to the alveoli of the lungs where they break out. They crawl up the trachea and they're swallowed, and that's how they get to the digestive system. The adults mate in the intestine, produce eggs, and the eggs are shed in the feces. The eggs then hatch in the soil and we have larvae and the whole system starts again. Ascaris is more common in the southern states because we have relatively mild winters and the larvae can persist throughout the winter. Also in the southern states, we're more likely to go barefoot. Flip-flops has done a lot toward preventing this disease. Individuals are treated with antihelminthics. Also, wearing shoes is a good preventative measure. Now, these worms are pretty large and they can cause intestinal blockages. Sometimes these have to be surgically removed. There is a condition called creeping eruption. Dogs and cats also have species of roundworms. The dog roundworms will have their eggs hatch in the soil and would penetrate the skin of the dog in order to get it back into their intestine. If humans accidentally pick up this roundworm by going barefoot wherever dog feces are, the worm will travel under the skin trying to find the right place to be. Eventually, it will realize it's in the wrong host and will die, but in the meantime, it has migrated around under the skin and it causes an itchy rash. Anisakiasis is caused by Anisakis simplex. Now, this is normally a parasite of marine animals. It has a very complex life cycle with multiple hosts and larval stages. It starts out as an egg that's ingested by some marine animal, which is eaten by another animal, which is eaten by another animal, so it kind of goes through several fish. Eventually, dolphins and whales acquire it. It is in the dolphin and the whale that the larvae mature into adults. These marine mammals then shed the eggs and start the cycle over again. Humans are accidental hosts. They eat infected fish. The worms will mature in the esophagus, the stomach, and the intestine. This can cause a hypersensitivity. This is the mild form of the disease, and the worms can be removed by using an endoscope and tweezers on a cable. They can simply be picked out and removed from the digestive system. However, the worms may burrow through the stomach into the peritoneal cavity. Here there is severe pain and we have to have surgical removal of the worms. The worms are killed by cooking, so the best prevention is not to eat raw fish.